委員我們繼續
Members, let's continue with our meeting. We now handle Mr. Gary Fan's motion, which is being distributed to you. As I mentioned, Mr. Gary Fan has withdrawn his previous motion. Mr. Fan, would you please tell us the content of your motion? Well, I'm not totally withdrawing my motion. I just modified the wording. In 2014, the URA commissioned an independent consultant, McKinsey, to review the organizational structure and cost effectiveness of urban renewal, etc., of the Urban Renewal Authority. In the past, the URA consulted the LegCo on urban renewal strategy. This panel urges the URA to consult the LegCo before adopting the recommendations of the McKinsey report and to pass the consultancy report to the LegCo. Mr. Chen Kamlan, I do not support the motion. The consultant is to advise the URA. Whether or not this proposal is acceptable to the URA, I believe they have to discuss this internally first. They cannot breach the statutory terms of reference of the URA. So I don't think they need to submit the consultancy report to the LegCo. I'll put the motion to the vote. Mr. Gary Fan, well, I claim a division. All right, Mr. Fan claims a division. Those in favor of handling this motion, please raise their hands. Two, four. Those against handling the motion, please raise their hands. Lo Wai Kwok, Elizabeth Kwok, Chan Hak Kan, Yu Si Wing, Chan Kam Lan, Alice Mack, Abraham Sheik, Regina Ip, Chan Kim Po. Nine against, 2-4. I declare that this motion will not be handled. So much for our discussion on this item. Let's proceed to the next item on the agenda. Progress report on heritage conservation initiatives. Please invite the government representatives to come in. First of all, I'd like to welcome the attending government officials. The name list has already been tabled. I won't introduce the officials one by one to you. I have to apologize to the government representatives. We've been keep you waiting because members were interested in the preceding issue. Well, altogether 19 members spoke in the first round, and we also had a second round. So, my apology. I'd like to know whether the government is to do a briefing. If so, who will do it? Mr. Chairman, perhaps I should start first. Bureau Director, starting from 2009, the Development Bureau made regular progress reports to the panel. This paper updates members on the progress made since June last year. I'd like to update you on the latest situation. First of all, review of the policy on monuments. We invited the AAB to conduct a review for us. We welcome the recommendations of the AAB. Now, I'd like to defer to Mr. Andrew Lam for the major recommendations of the AAB. At the invitation of the Development Bureau, the AAB spent about 1.5 years on the review of built heritage, carried out activities and consultation. We'd like to review past experience and understand social expectations. We would like to implement policies and move forward. And on crucial issues, we would like to recommend policy principles to the government as well as address social changes. The AAB had three areas of recommendations. First of all, we propose the establishment of a dedicated fund to provide resources for new projects like public education and public engagement and related activities, academic research, and so forth. The AAB is also of the view that the government should consider the size of the fund and the distribution of resources. Of course, the disciplines to be covered should also be studied, and in that process, the AAB will provide advice. The AAB does not consider that society will accept the use of public money to mandatorily conserve private buildings. That's the mainstream opinion we received. So the fund should not bear the cost incurred in this regard. Secondly, we're targeting privately owned historic buildings. So we need to provide a series of incentives to consolidate the existing mechanism to facilitate and attract private owners to conserve the historic buildings. Well, a number of approaches can be considered. At the moment, we have to satisfy the buildings ordinance, so there should be flexibility to encourage privately owned, or the owners of privately owned historic buildings to maintain their buildings well. And we would like the government to implement our recommendations. As for incentives, the existing incentives cover repair and maintenance, redevelopment opportunities, and risks. We would like to have more systematic mechanisms like relaxation of plot ratio, land exchange, and more flexibility in terms of subsidy. As for the size, conditions, and heritage value of historic buildings, we would like to set up an assessment system and more publicity should be done for the incentives. We also target the need for long-term development. Well, dotted line plane had been mentioned, and purely administrative grading would not be sufficient. It really depends on the knowledge of the public on all these issues. Maybe members of the public don't have in-depth knowledge on these aspects. Heritage value, what should be preserved, what not, etc., etc. We need to conduct more in-depth studies before we can come up with more specific recommendations. As for medium and long-term development, the government should do preparation. So these are the three major areas of recommendations the AAB submitted to the government. Bureau Director, Mr. Chairman, we've set up a dedicated group to implement the AAB's recommendations. A conservation fund for conserving built heritage had been set up. As for revitalization of historic buildings, we've also set up a dedicated group to follow up on the recommendations. And we had several rounds of exchanges with the representatives of the academia and the stakeholders. As for partnership, just last week we announced the result of Phase 4. At Tai Hang, we'll have a revitalization project. And in Pok Fu Lam, the dairy farm senior officers' quarters will also be revitalized. And for the Lady Ho Tung building, it will also be revitalized as an ecology study center. And then another statutory monument will be kept under the management of the government to be open to the public for visits. And in the long run, we'll study the long-term model of revitalization. Before opening up the monument to the public, we'll do upgrading, provide barrier-free access, and improve hygiene facilities. In order that members of the public can visit this very unique building in King Yin Lake, will adopt a number of measures. As regards the old Taipo police station, renovation was completed in April. For the old Taipo police station, is under a trial run. Members of the public will be able to appreciate the awareness of revitalization of historic monuments. As for Phase 3, Batch 3, we are preparing the tendering documents and layout plans for the three projects. For private projects, the former Shaw Studio was graded Grade 2. We've started discussion on that historic building. Earlier, the owner submitted an application for demolition, but afterwards the owner withdrew the application and is now studying how to integrate development with conservation. As for Shaoxing Central Link, heritage articles have been discovered in the course of construction. For the relics from the Song and Yuan dynasties, we would proceed with in situ preservation.
We also consider exhibiting some of the uncovered artifacts in the future station of SCL, and we would consult the AAB in due course. So members, we have two members who would like to ask questions, Dr. Kenneth Chan and Dr. Lo Wai Kuo. Each member is given 5 minutes. Dr. Chan, Hawthorne Gardens is a painful experience. Even if you ask everyone to remain calm and composed in talking about it, we strive for that to be preserved for years, and now it's been demolished because it's private property. Every time you go up to the peak, you see that there's a site along the way. At the Tokwa Wan textile factory, only the wall is preserved. For Shao Studio, the owner has withdrawn the previous application for redevelopment. As Mr. Andrew Lam has said, the mentality is simply not there, that we should be more proactive to do preservation, and owners should also consider doing something to preserve valuable monuments for Hong Kong. And there's also problem with the system. Although you have a monitoring system, but there are a number of parties involved, different statutory bodies are involved, the Town Planning Board and government departments are also involved, such as the Buildings Department. But there's no one-stop coordination mechanism. When government departments or Town Planning Board or Lands Department receive application for land sale or for redevelopment, and you know that the administrative grading is not binding, so shouldn't there be a mechanism to withhold redevelopment so that the community and the government can have some time to enter into a discussion with the owner? So that's the first thing. Secondly, I want to touch on a number of aspects. The former CGO, I've talked to the DOJ recently. You know that the central wing and the west wing would be reserved for DOJ as an office, and there will be a public space. So, Chairman, when it comes to the railings built in the C.H. Tong era, some NGOs, some people in the community would like to take them down. So how can we strike a balance? Because the government offices there may also need some railing. I hope that we can remove some and keep some. It's government building, it's for government use, and also, but it's also for public use, so the participation by stakeholders is important. We should try to match public expectations and vis-a-vis the needs of government departments. And secondly, I'm concerned about the auditor's report, number 60. There are a number of buildings waiting to be graded. and some of those are under the control of the PRA garrison. In this year's special FC meeting, I asked the officials this question about the progress. He said that there is some preliminary preparation being done. I'm not asking you to break into the premises, but I'd like to have a procedure, a timetable to do the grading job properly. I think within the PLA garrison, the relevant buildings to be graded are valuable assets. It's important to enhance transparency. Lastly, I want to talk about the old stone wall in Hong Kong Park. Some NGOs have asked the AB to involve the AMO to look into the importance of these things. Who would answer these questions?
好啊,林主席,麻煩。
I'll defer to the chairman of AAB. Let me first of all talk about CGO. The role of the AAB is the assessment, the impact assessment, and we have to decide or discuss what to preserve and what not to preserve. And sometimes there's a difference of opinion between experts and the public. Sometimes among experts, their views also differ. But this heritage impact assessment is an open and transparent process. And very often, interested individuals will let us know their views, and sometimes we also hold special sessions to receive public opinion. This is so that in our decision-making process, we can fully take into account such views. At the end of the day, we have to make a decision as regards whether the heritage impact assessment is accessible or not. But it all boils down to a matter of judgment. Should the railing and fence be demolished? Well, there are divergent views. There are conflict of different principles, because new additions introduced at different periods might also have heritage values. But under the HIA, the recommendation is to remove them, and the Bureau has not insisted that it should be preserved. Mr. Lam, I'd like to respond to two of the issues raised by Dr. Chen, and that is within the PLA garrison sites, there are historic buildings that we need to grade. Last time when we answered Dr. Chen's question, the situation was more or less the same. The Security Bureau has contacted the PLA and they have agreed to tie in to cooperate with our grading procedure. It's a procedure similar to that applicable to the grading of buildings not on government sites or not owned by government. Also, they would do their part in complementing our grading procedure. As for the relocation of Harcourt Road, a pumping station affecting historic stone walls in Hong Kong Park, and also the tree preservation issues, we are now exploring other alternatives for this project, and also we have regard to the urgency of the project, and we would review the case and we'll consider members' views. The project will not be launched at this stage. We would carry out review first, and we'll come back to report to members later. What about the withholding the mechanism? Perhaps you should ask, let Dr. Lo Weikok ask his questions first. Thank you. Well, the revitalizing historic buildings through partnership scheme has borne some fruit, because for the first and the second batches, the historic buildings have been put to new uses. For example, the former Lichikok Hospital is now Yao Zhong Yi Academy. It used to be a lunatic asylum. And there's a catering facility, and there a space for cultural activities. Well, it's running very well. I've led some friends to visit the academy, and they are very satisfied with that. And of course, we want this to go on smoothly, and then it can be self-financing. But when it comes to the monitoring the operation of the academy, what is the mechanism? For example, how can you tell whether the heritage preservation element or objective can be achieved? And also, is it sustainable in its operation? And if the partners have problems, financial problems in particular, and the plan may fall through, so what are your contingency plans? Do you have such plans just in case? And I'm happy that we are going to see the launching of batch 3 and batch 4, so that we can revitalize historic buildings, and premises are provided that they can provide different services that meet the needs of the wider public. I'll ask the DS, Mr. Albert Lam, to respond. On the question of the partnership scheme, we have launched 4 batches. The Yao Zhongyi Academy belongs to the first batch. In the word partnership is in the name of the scheme, so that means that we collaborate with NGO in revitalizing historic buildings, and in the process we have been facing new challenges. We have just got a few projects completed. In the Yao Zhongyi Academy, there's premises for cultural activities, and there are also some commercially oriented facilities. We want to make sure that this can be enjoyed by more people. The NGO has to submit a detailed plan, and they have to give some undertaking. For example, in the first few years, the government will provide some financial assistance, but in the long term, the NGO must come up with a modus operandi that would be sustainable. And we assess their proposals based on the certain criteria. For example, the conservation, the preservation elements, the heritage element, and they will have to promise that for certain times in the week or in the month, they will open the facilities to the public, and there will be guided tours. In the CHO, Commissioner for Heritage Office, there will be regular reviews to see if the original objective is achieved, or whether there are new circumstances warranting some new arrangements. We will work out things with the NGOs as partners.
Mr. Chairman, what I said just now is subjective views are good. At the moment, they're operating well. But if they adopt a commercial modus operandi, then of course they would like to have sustainability and be able to balance their books. Now, this objective is good, but you have to adopt precautionary measures as well. If commercial operations prove not to be viable, what should happen? That's the crux of my question. Any response from the Secretary? I'd like to thank Dr. Lo Wai Kwok for his question. Concerning his concern, for approved projects, for certain operators, they fall below the original expectation. For such cases, we'll try to help them to see how they can improve their operation. And sometimes, vetting by government departments is necessary. Sometimes, individual items of a particular project may need sponsorship. In that process, we'll try to provide assistance. Well, up to now, by and large, the situation is rather stable. Well, Mr. Kenneth Chan would like to follow up on his previous questions, but I personally want to ask a question. Well, just now, the Bureau Director said that the AAB proposed dedicated groups to follow up on the recommendations. I'm concerned about progress and timetable. What about the membership of these groups? Can you give us more details in a moment? Now, conservation involves private premises, private properties, as Mr. Kenneth Chan said. You have to provide incentives to these owners. They consider it a loss if their right to development is lost. So you must not allow the owner to be overburdened. So I'd like to follow up on this. We got some precedents. For example, the private property in the Old Peak Road, the Lugard Road property. Well, this is not unique to Hong Kong. In other jurisdictions, they also have similar examples. So I wonder whether you can tell us your follow-up work. Mr. Lam? Mr. Chairman, concerning development projects and conservation projects, well, maybe I should also answer Mr. Kenneth Chan's question about monitoring. After identifying a historic building, if revitalization is possible, we'll be able to get information from departments like the planning department or the buildings department or the architectural services department. Under the existing mechanism, the AMO will be informed. Then we'll proactively contact the owner concerned to say what measures the government has for development come conservation. In the course of grading, we'll tell the owner what characteristics should be preserved. For grade 1 buildings, we would like the whole building to be preserved. Mr. Chan asked whether or not we've asked owners to stop and think about the project. Yes, we did so. I can recall that in a year after the announcement, under the law, government permission was necessary. Well, sorry, Mr. Lam, I have to interrupt you. I know the mechanism, but for the property owner, you have to provide more incentives. Follow-up work is not enough. The internal of the building is also important. Take, for example, the bathroom of a privately owned building may be very valuable, but the owner may demolish the bathroom or toilet. Well, these owners feel that their rights and interests are undermined. They consider themselves suffering a loss. So you have to strike a balance. Yes, many owners don't mind preserving the features of historic buildings, but some owners do mind. I understand that you will discuss partnership with these owners. Under the existing mechanism, many problems have been identified. You have to handle them. What about the dedicated groups? Any more details? Well, Mr. Chairman, for the follow-up groups, well, some of them are internal units. For example, together with the buildings department, we try to see what improvement can be made to the building code. And then for other stakeholders like surveyors, architects, engineers, and so forth, we have sat down with them every now and then to discuss relevant issues. For example, improvement to the building code. We also ask the professional bodies and the stakeholders whether or not our direction is correct, whether we've been spending sufficient effort on a particular project, etc., etc. What about compensation and incentives for preservation? On the one hand, you are familiar with strategies like land exchange, transferring, plot ratio, and so forth, or relocation of the exact location of the building. Well, apart from all these, are there other possibilities? Well, in the past, we mainly adopt the compensation approach. Say, because of conservation, you lose 10 square feet, then we'll give you back 10 square feet. Well, perhaps this is not actually an incentive. It's more compensation in nature. So in order to provide more incentives for historic buildings, we'll see whether we can have more flexibility. Dr. Kenneth Chan? Well, we should adjourn at 5:45. But I can exercise a discretion to extend the meeting to 6 p.m. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I absolutely welcome this opportunity to follow up on my previous question. I don't know how many members are very concerned about this very important issue of heritage conservation policy. We'll look at Government Hill. Dotted line is something abstract to some members of the public. Now, the Government Hill is a good example. Well, maybe the government doesn't want to talk about Government Hill, but among members of the public, many organizations and individuals are very interested in Government Hill. which used to be a political center when Hong Kong started to develop. I believe the concept of Government Hill will sooner or later emerge. So maybe the bureau director and his officials should go back and consider how to make use of this opportunity to present this dot line plane approach. And what about the notification mechanism among government departments? I understand the mechanism, but the question is it enough? Do we need to further enhance it? If we are to do so, maybe independent and eloquent and outspoken members or colleagues of the AMO will have to speak more on the subject. I hope you don't mind this remark of mine, because the Development Bureau shouldn't just look at conservation. It has other tasks. I may not 100% agree to the concept of dot line plane. Anyway, in order to strike a balance, we sometimes may have to go to the other extreme in order to balance your viewpoints. So maybe you should give more room to independent and outspoken experts to air their views on preserving the heritage value of historic buildings, be it companies or individuals. They shouldn't just sit there and wait for you to finish policy implementation in a year. So, conservation is not just about buildings. To strike a balance is important. I heard that some independent and outspoken experts were rather disappointed by your approach. I think you should allow such voices to speak out. Even for the stone wall, many members of the public have spoken out. So please look at the wall seriously. I understand that you have conducted an assessment, but the assessment result is that it is not of a high value because not many people know about it. But of course, it's because the LCSD has been using it as a nursery bed and has been shielding it off from the public. So you should let members of the public to know more about this 150-year-old stone wall. Its function in terms of defense and so forth. Then, at the end, you'll be able to preserve the stone wall. You should also explain the history behind that wall. Again, this is also a dot line plane approach. I'd like to see our government officials support such a process. Well, let me first say something about the ancient stone wall. The documents we received and discussions that we attended did not indicate that the value assessed by us has been affected by the degree of knowledge of the public.
I wonder if you know there's a commemorative plaque to mark the race course fire at So Kwan Po. We have proposed that this be made a monument. Not many people know about that plaque. And we, of course, are very saddened by the loss of Houghton Gardens. Actually, the AAB unanimously agreed that it should be made a monument. The value of Houghton Gardens is much better than King In Lay. But in terms of visibility, the public know much more about King In Lay, and they support. They gave more support for the preservation of King In Lay. And even if we play the trump card, the government department will have to consider wider issues. For meetings that I chaired, I would not try to sway the members in one way or another. The members have their own views, but every time we will stress that in heritage conservation must be the first priority. And for the preservation of the size of Sha Tin Central Linked Heritage, conservation must be the first priority for us. But we cannot ignore that there are other issues. We cannot bury our heads in the sand. But in the AAB, there's no need for AAB to do the balancing act, so to speak. Secretary, Dr. Low,
就唔會好長篇嘅。關於個香港
，I won't be long. I went to inspect the stone wall in the park, in Hong Kong Park. Yes, the stone wall itself is not a big structure historically. You may be able to find out that during certain time. The British garrison did something there. But according to the government departments that I contacted, well, the proposed option was feasible. The pump station has to be repositioned. And originally, the wall that was behind the fire station. So it's the right location for the pumping station to be rehoused there. I think it would be good in the long term for the stone wall. There's the nursery there. It's not a very safe structure as it stands. If the repositioning project goes ahead, and if we can strengthen the structure, the stone wall, it would be good in the long run. And as regards the Sha Tin Central Link conservation, the departments did the right thing. They did the assessment and they proposed certain conservation measures. But we have to consider whether everything should be conserved in situ. In many museums, you know that for some it can be conserved in situ, but for some others, it's better to conserve the relics in a museum. I'm not suggesting that the ancient drain channels and the well should be dealt with like this. And now we have a feasible, workable option. If the community thinks this worth the cost of deferring the completion of the railway project, well, we have to make some sacrifice. We need to do the balancing exercise. So I just want to give you my views from the engineering angle. In the future, for public works project or even for private projects, we have to expect sometimes we have to deal with heritage conservation. We need to do some balancing act, and there should always be a objective and rational discussion. Thank you, Dr. Low, for your opinion. Your points are noted. I think let's end the discussion of this item first. AOB, if there's nothing under AOB, meeting's adjourned. Thank you for your attendance.